Ministers frequently tell lost people that they need to pray the sinner's prayer. Well, what exactly is the sinner's prayer? Is this prayer biblically based? And if not, what is its origin? The so-called sinner's prayer is a popular phenomenon in the Protestant circles. It is employed at the conclusion of various denominational revival services and appeals to convince sincere people to get saved. It frequently is found as the ending in gospel tracts, urging folks to repeat these words from the bottom of your heart. The sinner's prayer takes various forms, all of which have the same general thrust. And here is one form of it. Heavenly Father, I know that I am a sinner and that I deserve to go to hell. I believe that Jesus Christ died on the cross for my sins. I do now receive him as my Lord and Savior. I promise to serve you to the best of my ability. Please save me. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, the following observations concerning this prayer should be carefully considered. First, is the sinner's prayer in the New Testament? The sentiments of this prayer are found nowhere in the literature of the New Testament that pertains to the sinner's responsibility under the law of Christ. A careful study of the cases of conversion in the book of Acts will reveal that in not a single instance is the sinner instructed or encouraged to pray for his or her salvation. Rather, those honest souls who longed for redemption were admonished to believe on the Lord, Acts 16:31, repent and be immersed for the forgiveness of their sins, Acts 2:38 and Acts 22:16. This in order to enjoy a relationship with Christ, as in Galatians 3:27, and to enter his spiritual body, referencing 1 Corinthians 12, verse 13. Well, what about Acts chapter 2, verse 21? Some claim that Acts 2:21 is a proof text for the so-called sinner's prayer. Let's compare this verse with several others from the same book and the same author. And it shall be that whosoever call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Acts 2, verse 21. And Peter said unto them, repent ye, and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Acts chapter 2, verse 38. And now why tarriest thou? Arise and be baptized, and wash away thy sins, calling on his name. Acts chapter 22, verse 16. The claim that Acts 2:21 provides authority for the sinner's prayer is baseless. The call contemplated in this passage was fulfilled when penitent sinners surrendered to the terms of the gospel plan of redemption, explicitly announced later on the same occasion. The forgiveness of sins, verse 38, is the equivalent of saved, verse 21. Accordingly, the call of verse 21 is obviously a generic term which embraces the repent and be immersed, which was commanded of believers in verse 38. Moreover, this calling or obedience connection is further established in Acts 22, verse 16. Note that the very act of submitting to the Lord's command to be immersed is the manifestation of calling on his name. 2. Saying, Lord, Lord, is not enough. Scripture elsewhere makes it very clear that the mere act of calling out the Lord's name in an attempt to access divine mercy in the absence of obedience is an exercise in futility. The Lord says, Not everyone who says unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. And this is a present tense verb in Matthew 7, verse 21. Again, the Savior pointedly inquired, And why do you call me, Lord, Lord, and do not the things that I say? Luke chapter 6, verse 46. Next, the prayer is for the child of God. Prayer is an avenue of communication between a blood-bought child of God and his heavenly Father. The model prayer begins, Our Father in heaven, Matthew 6, 9. One becomes a child of the Father by means of the born-again process, not by praying. This is referenced in John 3, verse 3 through 5. Saul's prayer did not save him. Saul of Tarsus prayed for 3 days after arriving in the city of Damascus, yet his sins were not washed away until he was immersed in water in obedience to the divine command. Reference Acts 9:11 and Acts 22:16. If there ever was a case of the sinner's prayer being exercised, surely this was it. Yet, it was all for naught. 3. Where did the sinner's prayer originate? The sinner's prayer probably evolved in some form or another in the early days of the Protestant Reformation movement as a misguided reaction against the Roman Catholic dogma of justification by means of meritorious works. For example, Jacobus Faber, circa 1450 through 1536, who has been called the father of the French Reformation, though he never formally left the Catholic Church, wrote a commentary on the epistles of Paul in 1512. This was 5 years before Luther's break with the Roman Church in Germany. In this volume, Faber argued that justification is obtained through faith without works. Later, rebelling against the merit-works system of Romanism, Martin Luther would contend that salvation is on the basis of faith alone. And according to one biographer, Luther exclaimed, I, Dr. Martin Luther, unworthy herald of the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, confess this article that faith alone, without works, justifies before God. So convinced was Luther of this proposition that when producing his own translation of the New Testament, he altered the text of Romans 3, verse 28 to read, A man is justified by faith only. The word only is not in any Greek manuscript available. Luther even rejected the divine origin of the book of James because of its emphasis on works in addition to faith. To believe, therefore, that one may be justified from sin by simply praying the sinner's prayer as a substitute for obedience to the plan of salvation is to labor under a delusion that is void of biblical support. And undoubtedly, many who offer the sinner's prayer are exceedingly sincere, but sincerity alone, however, is unavailing and unbiblical. And you might reference Proverbs 14:12, Acts 23:1, and Acts 26:9. May God bless you in your studies.